Good evening, everybody. Ooh, and we are live. Welcome to the, what month are we in? May 2021 edition of the B-List Book Club. We begin, as always, by acknowledging that we are gathering on what always was and always will be Aboriginal land. Here at the State Library of New South Wales in Sydney, that means Gadigal land of the Eora Nation. We pay our respects to elders past and present. And I encourage the incredibly numerous audience we have watching from home as well to take a moment and consider the lands on which you are at the moment. We are tonight going to be hearing from Fiona Murphy about her incredible debut memoir, The Shape of Sound. I'm just going to read what I thought about it, think about it. I love this book so much. Every now and then you come across a book that really makes you see your world anew. In the case of The Shape of Sound, Murphy has allowed me to hear something new. More than a memoir, this book reveals both glorious and shocking things about sound and society that I'd never even realized I didn't know. Murphy revels in words, finding the most extraordinary ways to render the body and mind as sometimes warring, sometimes synchronous. This book is special. It offers a unique and committed voice, sure of the right things whilst also unsure of the right things. I challenge anyone to come away from reading The Shape of Sound without at least a handful of revelations. Mark the name Fiona Murphy. Fiona is a deaf poet and essayist. Her work has been published in Kill Your Darlings, Overland, Griffith Review, and The Big Issue, among other publications. In 2019, she was awarded the Overland Fair Australia Essay Prize and the Monash Undergraduate Creative Writing Prize. In 2018, she was shortlisted for the Rochelle Prize and highly commended by the Wheeler Centre Next Chapter program. Fiona lives in the Blue Mountains in New South Wales. The Shape of Sound is her first book. Please give her a very warm welcome.
Thank you.
Tell us about some of your earliest memories of your mum helping you with words.
I think help is a word that I kind of use now. Like when I was younger, it was more like, oh, that chair. So growing up, I was really struggled to learn how to read and write. And I was very aware that this was an issue for me because like looking around the classroom, just the ease of everyone kind of following instructions, picking up their pens and like off they went. The fact that they actually had pens as well. I didn't get my pen license. I still don't have my pen license.
Published author without a pen license.
I know, it's such a, oh. But that's great awareness that this was a challenge for me. But my mum was really great in kind of promoting the idea that, yeah, this is a challenge. This is going to be hard, but we're here to support you. And she's really practical. And I think that really has stuck with me well of she would break things down into little bite parts. So if there was a word like apple, she'll be like apple, app, apple. So she was really into syllables and phonics. And she did finish her high school education, and then after high school the only opportunities for her was to leave her home in Ireland because it was a continuous recession and she had to move to London to secure any work. And the kind of further education she got was on the job becoming a nurse. So she was super practical in kind of the sort of education that she had and the way that she delivered that to me as well, of being really grounded in sort of the basics, as she says, instead of basics. She's like, just think of the basics. And that's something that I do as well. And I still do that when I approach a word. I break it down into parts and all those kind of little tricks and tips of sounding them out and making the word as physical as possible. I'm very musical approach to words.
Tell us about the first, some of the examples you give in the book of when there were moments in your childhood when you realized there was a difference between you and the others. And the examples I'm thinking of perhaps are like the swimming and with your siblings getting frustrated with your speaking.
Yeah, absolutely. So one of the things of being born deaf, I had to be told what was a normal way of hearing and kind of picking up how other people exist in the world. And a striking example is when I was about 15 or 16, I can remember an audiologist saying to me, "And that's why you don't know where sounds come from." And I was like, what do you mean by that? And he was like, "Oh, you know, people with two functioning ears can locate sound." I'm like, "What do you mean by this?" And that idea of that you can have your eyes closed, yet you know fairly accurately where a voice is coming from, where footsteps are coming from. You know if somebody's standing behind you or in front of you. That idea of being able to locate other people in an environment, let alone yourself, without your eyes was just astonishing to me. And it had to be told to me. Another example of kind of playing Marco Polo, I just thought I was really shit at swimming. Like I had no idea. I would flounder around the pool, never actually find anyone when I had my eyes closed. And I was like, I'm just really bad at sports here. I just didn't connect the dots that it had anything to do with my hearing at all. And why would I? Because I've never been able to locate sound before. And kind of having these little bits of information told to me over the years really made me realize, gosh, that would have been really handy to kind of have a list or know these things, just to know from kind of that thinking level of the amount of thinking and problem solving that I do on a daily basis would explain why I've always felt really tired, but I just thought I was really lazy.
And what about the example you gave of I'm interested in it from a language perspective as well. I think it was your brother that got frustrated because you would speak like halfway through a sentence.
Yeah, I didn't realize I had this habit at all until one of my dear brothers, in a very loving way, was, "Why won't you finish your sentences?" And he was very much like, "Nobody can read your mind." And I would have been about 16 or so. And as soon as he said it, I was like, huh, I definitely knew nobody could read my mind. Like at that fundamental level, I knew that, yeah, nobody can read my mind. But I hadn't realized that the mannerisms that I was approaching a conversation was very much how I heard a conversation. So to me, I would miss things and have to work hard to fill in the gaps. And I assumed that that level of work is what everyone was willing to do in a conversation. So that kind of almost magical thinking of mind reading would come into it. So I would be like, "Bri, and the book, you know," and just like serious gaps in my sentences, super fragmented. And when he pointed it out, it was like this real just kind of shift in my head of like, geez Louise, this is a thing that I do. I really just stop and kind of expect someone to, like, you know, pick up the slack and off they go, because that's the sort of experience that I have when listening to others or when somebody I'm talking to turns away and I like miss that part of the sentence. So when they turn back, I get the other half and I have to pick it up and problem solve and think and think and think. So when he did point that out to me, I got really pedantic when I was talking, like so pedantic, like I would hammer out every single word, make sure I got to the end of the sentence. And it was obviously over the top and something that I had to relearn in my late teens, early 20s of like, okay, how do I relax into this idea of being a hearing person when I talk to other people, so less deaf in the way I approach conversations, which again was another level of thinking and work that I've had to put in.
So for people who haven't read the book yet, tell us about the day your mum took you into the city to get the tests done and what you, I guess, found out that day.
So When I was about 6 years old, at that point, it was quite clear that I was not excelling at school. Like, I was really struggling with learning how to read, learning how to write. My swimming instructor at the time was like, she's floundering. She's really not following instructions at all. Maybe there's something wrong with her ears. And my teacher was like, oh, she's like really polite, but she can't do anything. Maybe she has a learning disorder. So that was kind of the thing that was hanging over it. Is there a disorder of some sort? So mum bundled me up. We went from Bankstown into the city, and it was kind of like all these games and stuff. And I'm like super competitive. So I'm like, you know, doing these games, and that was all fine. And interestingly, I did well in those games, and I could understand the concepts of building blocks and all the rest of it. Like, yay me, go the building blocks. And then when it came to the second part of the day, I had a hearing test, and I can vividly remember it was kind of this actual carpet material, but you step into a little booth and there's kind of that carpeting material on all the walls, and you have a little stool that you sit on, and there's a window that you can stare out, and there's the audiologist or technician on the other side, and you're given like this little button thing to press. And what they do is listen to the tones, and when you hear the tone, press the button. And it's always in that kind of flight attendant, very smooth way, and you kind of step in. And I'm sitting there, and I do this every time I have a hearing test, like even now, just like sweating my way through.
I'm going to ace this.
I'm going to be the best at this. And like, there I am, just like pressing away. And occasionally I'm like, yeah, I think that's a sound. Let's press away anyway. And then they put all this interference and things like that, ways of tricking your brain. So your, in my instance, my functioning ear, the right ear, doesn't compensate for the left ear. So it's all this, it's quite an extensive process that they go through to kind of trick and outsmart your brain. And at the end of it, it was like a shock for both my mum and myself. It's like, I'm profoundly deaf in my left ear, to the point that if I was born now, I would be implanted with a cochlear ear implant, because no hearing aids would actually be powerful enough to render any form of functional hearing in my left ear. So that was kind of, suddenly things made sense, but it was also like, oh, this is a diagnosis. Like, what is this? And my mum, being very practical, was like, what do we do? Hearing aids, sign language. And they're very much like, at that stage, we're like, she's really social. She's really polite and nice. You've got a good girl. She'll be fine.
My sense was that at that time, and basically what you've just said, the recommendation was to essentially get you like compensating in all kinds of ways, and that the success would be if you could pass as somebody who had two fully hearing ears.
Not even compensating. I think by that point I was already quite proficient at compensating, in that I was social, I was polite, I could talk. And that's a really key marker, and is still a key marker, unfortunately, in children who are born with hearing loss, is have they acquired a level of fluency with their speech? And because I could speak fluently, there was an understanding that, her brain works, she'll be fine. She may get a little bit tired and frazzled, but she'll be fine. And there wasn't even a focus on the idea that my literacy at that point was abysmal. Like, I was illiterate, completely illiterate. And it was really my mum being so firm and passionate about education and being like, no, she needs the support. And there was, I went to a public school, so there wasn't a lot of support. There was a few mums that kind of volunteered to help with reading time, and bless the poor mum who was paired with me, because I was polite in some sense, but geez, I was such a brat when I didn't get things right. I didn't get a lot of things right with my reading, so I was horrendous. So I my mum had to really take charge at home. And that's why those kind of reading lessons after school every day was foundational in giving me the skills to become literate. And I think without those, my kind of educational outcomes would have been just shocking. And it's not unusual. Those educational outcomes are shocking in children who are deaf and hard of hearing. Either they're missed out or labelled as troublemakers or disinterested, or they become quite reclusive within themselves. And that skill of asking for access and accommodation is not taught. And those children aren't given they're not empowered to even know how to ask for help. Well, certainly that was in the 90s when I was going through school. It was very much like, you get what you got, off you go.
Why do you think you weren't like sort of taught sign, and how do you now feel about that?
It was definitely considered a last resort. Very much coming back to the idea that if you can speak, you've made it, like big tick to you. You've kind of assimilated into the wider society and you have a degree of fluency there. That view is still prevailing, and there's a lot of dodgy research and kind of medical rhetoric around the idea that sign language isn't a full and complete language, and you're doing your child a disservice by exposing them to this broken English, which is completely false and has been refuted numerous times with really robust scientific evidence and a linguistic evidence that it is a full and complete language with grammar and syntax. But unfortunately, it's still very much told, the medical fraternity told parents that it's the last resort. Don't do that to your child. Your child's brain will not develop and will be deficient in all capacity. So get the hearing technology, push them towards speech as much as you can. And it's heartbreaking because a child's brain needs language. And if you're pushing a language that is taxing and difficult onto a child, they're not going to excel completely, and they're not going to flourish to the degree of if they were exposed to a language that suited their body and that they didn't have to put that literal sweat into learning something, that they would just fly. So the kind of the position that the World Health Organization and a lot of really prominent and fantastic deaf academics and researchers is that children who are deaf or hard of hearing should have a bilingual education.
That's what I just wrote down. Sorry. Why not then bilingual, even if they think that a child has the potential to speak? What are there still?
It's still the stigma. It's still literally people in powerful positions in medicine saying, no, this will retard your child's brain. This won't give them the opportunities. We must make sure they can hear, because that's the only way the brain can develop. And that's just false. The brain does not need sound in order to develop. It needs language, socialization, connection, and community. And regardless of the degree of hearing loss within a child, there's still quite a stigma of or belief system around if a child has mild hearing loss, they'll have mild difficulties. If a child has moderate hearing loss, they'll have moderate difficulties. And profound, they'll have profound difficulties. But sound and hearing doesn't work like that at all. So a child with mild hearing loss could have very significant learning difficulties and challenges that they have to overcome. So this idea that the amount of decibels that you can hear and the amount of effort that you have to exert is completely false, but that's sort of the methodology that's kind of sold by medicine. But there, it's because it's such a diagnostic model. They give a solution and then they step back, and then it's up to the family and the community to kind of figure out where the gaps are to kind of fit in the solutions. And it completely disregards the kind of social and emotional aspects of what it's like to be deaf in a hearing world.
I want to come back to some specific questions I have about sign language, but for now I want to go further into this, the medicalization or the medical understanding of deafness. And perhaps for people who haven't read the book yet, can you explain that you come from a professional medical background and then tell us, I guess, about how you came to realize and understand the way medicine sort of historically views deaf people and deafness?
So my background is as a physiotherapist. Again, that was mum's kind of doing of being super practical. She's like, if you can work with your hands, you can take them anywhere, literally take your hands anywhere, go for physio, do that. And then for the next 15 years, she's gotten free physio. So she's a very clever woman. But that kind of foundational education that I had. So when I was going through university, I was still very much hiding my deafness throughout high school. And certainly even more so when I got to university, because I was like, oh, wait a second. Oh, this is a disability. What if nobody hires me because I can't hear very well? Oh no. And that's a real problem within health and medicine, is this idea that the doctor or the health professional needs to be of perfect health in order to deliver health. And there's a lot of barriers to actually get in. And one of the barriers when I was enrolling into physiotherapy was very much like, you need to be cool with stripping off naked. And I thought, okay, I don't mind that. Tick.
I can get around that.
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine. If everyone's taking their clothes off. And you also need to be able to be physically up to the task. And they didn't have a lot of detail around that. And I was like, does that include hearing or not? I'm just not going to tell anyone I'm deaf and just hope for the best. Since then, they've kind of put a little bit more kind of framing around it, and they have specifically to register as a physio, you need to be able to hear someone from 1.5 meters away. And I can, because like I've tested that with COVID so much. Yeah. And this was pre-COVID that they brought in the 1.5, and I'm like, oh, that's so serendipitous. But kind of through my training, I got a really solid grounding in the medical model of disability, which is very much the impairment model of you have an impairment or an inability to perform a task or function, and you either have there's treatments for that, or you have to kind of get around that impairment or dysfunction that you have. And it's very much centered on the problem being within the person. Later on, I learned about the social model of disability, which is kind of flipping that framework of, if we shaped our society and built our buildings in a different way and provided information in a way that was accessible, those disabilities and impairments will no longer be barriers. So that was a real shift in thinking I did later in life.
When did that happen, and how did you get to that shift?
It happened when I started hanging out with other disabled people. So up until that point, I was very much like, I'm a normal person living in a normal body, in a normal world. And I was working with disabled people. Like I was the practitioner, the clinician in those instances, but it was very much like, I'm going to save you. Don't you worry. I'll give you more exercises. You'll be fine and normal soon. And it was a deeply ableist view that I had. But it was only when I had moved to Melbourne and I accidentally enrolled in stand-up comedy. It was terrifying, but it was like a disability kind of awareness sort of program that I had enrolled in. And it was hanging out with really badass, really fucking hilarious disabled women that I was suddenly, whoa, what an asshole I've been. Like really just, I had so many deeply ingrained ideas about the medical model and what bodies are and what bodies should be, and this like ideal of a body. that it was a massive shock to me to realize that there could be another way of thinking and another way of existing in the world. And if we restructure things, that suddenly more people can participate as active citizens in a society.
Something that struck me when I was reading your book was that sort of people pay out women all the time, women in particular, but people as in general as well, pay out women all the time for following like bogus wellness, like guru goop style advice. But in the past sort of 3 to 5 years, we've seen, as one small example, a real spike in awareness around something like endometriosis. And we're starting to understand just how many thousands and thousands of people with that reproductive system who have been complaining to medicine and medical professionals and their doctors about excruciating pain and just being like completely gaslit and brushed off. And so they have had to go out and seek or try to find alternatives to the sort of traditional medical system. It struck me when I was reading some of the parts of your book where you talk about that their sort of traditional medicine often perpetuates this idea of the fully functioning body and then a dysfunctional body, and a body that has ability and then a body that has disability as just the perfection and then the absence of. Do you feel, I don't know, I guess it's a sort of kind of an open question. How do you understand people's exhaustion or suspicion of the medical establishment in relation to disability specifically, and whether they do people with disabilities often find themselves having to go elsewhere for proper sympathy and understanding? Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think fundamentally there is a deep level of distrust from the gaslighting perspective. But there's also a lot to be said about neoliberalism as well, and the way we've structured medical interactions and healthcare interactions. So I'm still working as a physiotherapist, and part of the funding structures that we have in place, you have to be of a certain age for me to see you. You have to meet a certain criteria. There's waiting lists, there's expectations of how quickly we will kind of do the assessment, see you, prescribe, exit. It's very much down to minutes is basically how they allocate funding. So I have to account for every day how many minutes I'm spending on each task. And obviously when you know that you're on a clock with minutes and that you've got KPIs, you're obviously going to be focusing, you're going to narrow your focus onto impairment and function and functional outcomes. So I think there's a lot to be said of people entering healthcare with a sense of empathy and drive and goodwill, and that being slowly eroded and crushed from healthcare practitioners by the systems that are in place. And even the funding models don't acknowledge preventative healthcare. So we could do so much to really empower and enable individuals, but the funding is not there, despite the research being there that preventative healthcare is fantastic and is cost saving. It's more kind of reactive care and dealing with crises as they come up. And I think we can't, in talking about healthcare, we must talk about neoliberalism in detail, because it impacts how health is provided and how health is received. Because a lot of, in terms of gaslighting, particularly with, say, endometriosis and people with symptoms like that, they're forking out a lot of money to try and get a diagnosis, and they're having to commit a lot of time and energy. So obviously there's going to be a level of distrust there, because you're just going to give up on the system. And something that I try and do as a disabled woman working in the system is to try and do patient-centered care in an actual real way, not the kind of lip service where the health system is like, yes, we do patient-centered care, but we also have KPIs, so off you go. It's really hard, but a lot of it.
What does that actually mean then when you say you do it in practice? Like, what would that mean for a patient coming to you?
I really watch my language now. So previously I was very much ableist in my thinking, and the way that I would frame things as being an impairment that has to be overcome. My approach now, particularly with a lot of people that I work with, they do have disabilities, and I use a more social model of like, instead of using kind of numeric and objective outcome measures, which are helpful for me as a clinician, they're not helpful and meaningful for the individual. So it's more like flipping goals to like, what would be a good outcome for you? How would you know that you're doing well, or that you're thriving with your life? And that's kind of shifts the conversation to, for example, I had a conversation with a client today, and that's another bugbear. We don't call them patients, we call them clients. Just so much capitalism all throughout. So I was talking to a client, and it was
a customer.
Yeah. And this customer said to me she had certain kind of objective measures that she had to meet and all the rest of it, but really she just wants to play with her grandkid. And just kind of shifting the conversation. Yes, I'm collecting objective measures and doing all the rest of it, but then just making the interaction, that kind of human interaction, as best we can within those kind of, you know, whilst it's on the clock, kind of bringing in those ideas of what will be a good outcome, what will make you know that you're kind of back on track to where you are. So I don't even use words like good leg, bad leg, and all the rest of it, because there's a lot of judgment in the way we're taught to analyze bodies and help bodies.
And then that was the way people would always talk to you. Well, which is your good ear and which is your bad ear?
Yeah. Absolutely. And it's just deeply ingrained in how we talk about things.
And it really hits home. That came through the book for me as well. What you mentioned just before about this sort of absurd farce that to be a healthcare professional or a healthcare worker of sort of any kind, you have to be the perfect model of like health, like what the system says is the perfect specimen, sort of. And the perspectives and the experiences that are ejected or rejected or not allowed into the traditional health system because of that are the very perspectives and experiences that could help improve it.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree more. And there's a really great organization in Australia of, I've forgotten the name. I think it's Disabled Doctors or Disabled Doctors for Medicine, something along that line. But there's such a small proportion of openly disabled people in the healthcare workforce. And I use that really matter-of-factly, because there's a lot of people who are hiding their disabilities out of fear of discrimination, stigma, and not getting employment opportunities. So chances are extremely high your healthcare professional has a disability, because one in five Australians has a disability. But we just don't have the confidence, skills, or trust to talk about it openly, because if you have an invisible disability, chances are super high you've heard some really ableist conversations around you, either in the workplace or socially and things like that. People say some really incredible things when they don't realize who they're talking to.
I hear and read similar things from any like people of color, or in Australia particularly Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, who like identify themselves as people who can pass quote unquote as non-Indigenous, and the shocking things people say about Indigenous Australians when they don't realize they're with somebody who identifies as Aboriginal or Torres Strait Islander.
It would be horrendous.
I would love for you to do your reading that we spoke about, please. We don't always do readings at B-List Book Clubs, but I felt it was really important for Fiona to do one, because something that happens when you write nonfiction about an issue, even if it's a memoir, is that people can often spend a lot of time talking about how important your work is, which is great. And this, you know, your work is really important, but it's also beautiful and just so fantastically written. And so I've asked Fiona to do a reading for us so that you can hear some of that yourselves, please. And if yes, if you could give a bit of context about the section.
Yeah. Brilliant. Thanks, Bri. And I'll say thanks, Mom. She doesn't know how to use Zoom or anything like that, so I'm like quite confident she's not watching. But I've said, like, yeah, she's really smart. She's great.
Well, the library staff told me there are 100 people signed in.
Bridget Murphy, if you're out there, yeah. This is for you. So this chapter is called Mother Tongue. It comes after the point that I start reckoning with the idea that I am a deaf person, which is a huge reckoning, not just somebody who happens to have only one functioning ear. And I had started learning sign language, which kind of led me on the way to kind of going, oh, wait a second, maybe I really am deaf. Who would have thought? And the chapter's called Mother Tongue. A few weeks after that first meetup of Ausland, I spoke bracingly to myself on the number 59 tram. Tonight you will talk. At the pub, drink in hand, I approached the table. Everyone said hello. Some replied when I asked, how are you, in sign. Throughout the evening, I repeated a handful of well-practiced signs, wedging them into conversations, all the while willing myself to be more carefree in my delivery. After attending a couple more Ausland meetups, I began to tick maybe when I received Facebook invitations for upcoming events. I told myself that I was being polite, that maybe perhaps my availability would change. The organizers thoughtfully varied the meetup times, acknowledging that everyone had different work and care responsibilities, and they selected meetup locations across a range of Melbourne suburbs, ensuring that every venue was close to train and tram lines. Yet whenever an event rolled around, I stayed home. Eventually, I stopped receiving notifications. The Facebook algorithm was more decisive, more honest than I was. It knew that I would ignore the invitations. Why my sudden disinterest in learning Ausland? Was it laziness, shyness, boredom, perfectionism? I implemented productivity hacks to reverse my inertia. Schedules, SMART goals, being specific, measurable, achievable, repeatable, timely, accountability apps. Nothing stuck. Ausland briefly allowed me to consider my body as something other than abject. It allowed me to recognize that the vast silent spaces within me had been waiting to be filled with language. This idea, although so warm, so full of new self-esteem, didn't last long. With each ignored Facebook notification, I distanced myself from Ausland. It seemed easier to stay absent from the deaf community. That way I could continue to dissociate from the deafness in my body. Even though I wasn't practicing sign language, I found myself buying books about deaf history. Google hadn't provided me with any clear answers. I still didn't know the correct way to describe my body. Was I medically or culturally deaf? Or both. I began to wonder if my craving for accurate terminology was a result of working within the medical model, where everything in the body carries a label. Conditions with unknown origins, including my deafness, are idiopathic, from the ancient Greek eidos, one's own, and pathos, suffering. By reading deaf history, I hoped to discover whether my questions about identity were just my own, or whether they were typical amongst people with hearing loss. I told no one about my research, mostly because I was worried with what I would find. Was my uncertainty over the past 20 odd years symptomatic of self-obsession and self-suffering rather than any real form of stigma? While everything in the body had been mapped by name and function, the brain remains a mystery. We cannot see it in full flight, twitching with thinkingness. Unlike the defined architecture of bone or the ropey strength of muscles, its appearance is merely lumpy. The outer layer, the neocortex, where our intellect prowls, looks like nothing more than a poorly folded, fitted sheet. Scientists think that it's the neocortex that separates us from animals. We think, therefore we are. In 1637, when René Descartes coined the phrase, "I think, therefore I am," he set the body free of God. Until then, it was widely believed that our thoughts were whispers from the divine and not our own creation. It's sickening to know that this philosophical argument has been used to suppress countless deaf lives. Cogito ergo sum. In three words, Descartes' Cartesian dualism made a swift and bloodless incision, dissecting the body into mind over matter. A bodily hierarchy was established. The tongue, anatomically described as the blade as it twists, rolls, and flicks air through the lips, became the brain's weapon. Language, lingua, tongue, or more specifically speech, was considered an indicator of intelligence and sanity. Whenever words arose from flesh, gestures, facial expressions, handshapes, they were considered wild, animalistic. For hundreds of years, deaf people used their bodies to speak were deemed subhuman. I needed to find the point in history where this brutal thinking dissolved and was replaced by the heft of reason. Over the next few months, I asked several local university and public libraries whether they had a deaf history archive or access to one via a database. One library had a handful of books, most of them printed in the late 1980s and early 90s. Their pages were yellowed and gritty with dust. As I read through them, my desire to find a hinge point in deaf history began to feel untenable. In Seeing Voices, Oliver Sacks writes that the congenitally dumb or deaf and dumb were considered dumb, stupid for thousands of years and were regarded as an unenlightened law as incompetent to inherit property, to marry, to receive education, to have adequately challenging work, and were denied fundamental human rights. The word incompetence struck me with the full force of recognition. All those years of enduring my internal monologue, exhorting myself to the point of exhaustion to prove my competency, work harder, prove you deserve to be here, prove your worth, prove you're capable. The unease I carried of being deaf in a hearing world felt ancient and inescapable.
Thank you. I've just realized how time has flown. I do want to leave 5 minutes for questions for the audience at the end, and that leaves me with a solid 10 minutes for you.
Solid 10.
Yes. And I have not tricky questions, but sort of chewy questions that I really want to get to. I was listening to an interview recently about a book that just came out in the States. I think it's out here as well. And it's called The Invention of Miracles, Language Power and Alexander Graham Bell's Quest to End Deafness by Katie Booth. And it's sort of a biography of Graham Bell. But for those, and most people know Graham Bell as the guy that invented the telephone. But he also, Booth's book attempts to fill a gap in the history of reporting around Graham Bell and his quest to end deafness. What did you find in your research about, is that the sort of hinge point that you were talking about when there was a change, if there was a change in thinking in terms of trying to get rid of deafness instead of embracing or accepting?
In some instances, yes, that was a hinge point of many hinge points. So there was actually a real deaf enlightenment in the late 1880s or heading into the 1880s, where deaf people had access to education and they had jobs and they were inventing things and they were really contributing members of society. And Alexander Graham Bell comes along and he has a deaf mum and a deaf wife, and he's like, "I'm gonna fix them, don't you worry, I'll fix them." And he invented the telephone, which was meant to be a form of communication to help his mum and his wife, and it went on to become revolutionary and it actually changed access for a lot of people. So when you say the phrase, I'll give you a bell, it comes from Alexander Graham Bell. And I say it all the time and I kind of kick myself because I hate him so, so much, like ridiculously a lot. And he's widely despised in the deaf community because he had all these beliefs of eugenic beliefs that were picked up because he was this dude who made this cool invention that everyone loved. And one of his strong beliefs of eradicating deafness was to ensure that no deaf person was to marry another deaf person for fear of passing the deafness on to the next generation. And all these ideas around ownership and property and self belief fundamentally changed any progress that had made. And it was a really small window of progress. So I don't want anyone to have the idea that deaf people were really accepted 1,000 years ago and it was amazing and cool, because they weren't. They were very much shunned from society. And this whole idea of stigma was an actual physical brandishing upon people with disability. They would be literally marked as different, physically marked or brandished. So it's a long, complex, deep history of deaf and disability oppression that its legacy rolls forward, and it's a living history because that stigma still exists, but it just shows up in different ways. It shows up in, for example, not providing access for job interviews, for example, not having interpreters or having ramps into buildings. This stigma is just so prevalent and present. But with Bell, his legacy definitely is complex because a lot of people just believed him.
You mentioned earlier this evening that these days it's very common for babies to get cochlear implants, but that the technology wasn't available when you were a baby, is that what it was?
At that stage, they weren't doing unilateral implants. They tended to do, if you were profoundly deaf, they would do kind of a bilateral approach. And there wasn't a lot of uptake in kind of putting one in, but that's changed completely now.
I have to admit that I had you write in the book about the marketing material that gets put out into the world about cochlear implants. Until I read your book, I just presumed that marketing material was accurate and that cochlear implants were just a silver bullet in the vast majority of cases. Can you explain why you rejected why you had a trial and then did not proceed with having the cochlears?
So I didn't trial a cochlear ear implant. This is a really good thing to bring up because there's a lot of different forms of technology. And generally as a society, it's kind of like, get a pair of hearing aids. It's like a pair of glasses is a phrase that's always brought up without any acknowledgement of the kind of cognitive demands that hearing aids carry, as well as the stigma and the emotional kind of response people have to hearing aids in general. In terms of a cochlear implant.
Oh my gosh, I didn't even, yeah.
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 All the time.
Oh, it's in the word.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Okay. Thank you.
And I also say Ausland. And there's no D on the end. There's something my mum's like, there's no D on the end. Fiona, stop saying land. I'm like, oh, I can't hear it. So with an implant, it's literally an implant into the brain, which then requires a minimum 2 years of intense rehabilitation to allow the brain to understand and remap to process sound. So it's an incredibly intensive physical and mental process that an individual has to go through. And in Australia, because the implant was invented in Australia and it's incredible, it's amazing, there is a real sense of pride that goes with it. And having the implant, you get it all paid for, as far as I believe. And it's a, if you make the choice, the funding's there and you get the rehabilitation. Interesting though, to get hearing aids, you get a really small voucher and you kind of go into a funnel where there's upselling and there's a lot of advertising and there's a lot of commissions that happen and there's a lot of undesirable work practices that might happen in the selling of hearing aids, where an individual has to kind of fend for themselves of what hearing aids they should get. And there's a lot of really horrendous stories of particularly older Australians or vulnerable people, which is deaf people. They always call us vulnerable. And that's really because of the communication barrier of them being ripped off. Yet with cochlear implants, it's like this amazing miracle free ride that the government is like super proud of, and they're implanting babies without having that conversation with the family of other alternative options and the idea of deaf role models and integrating someone into kind of a cultural perspective. And it's quite interesting being a deaf person, meeting other deaf people, and this kind of sense of like relief of being like, we found each other. Holy hell, how were we alone for so long? We found each other. Because there is that kind of young deaf people are segregated off from other deaf people because they're kind of funneled into being normalized as much as possible.
What, like they're afraid that they'll encourage each other? Is that like what they don't want to?
No, it's more a curative model. It's kind of this idea of, right, we fixed it. You're no longer deaf. When really kind of a deaf perspective is no matter what technology you have, and it's great if you have technology and it works for you, like amazing, like brilliant. That is so cool. You're no less deaf if you have technology. And there's this real misconception that came from this politicized movement in the 1980s and the early 90s that deaf people hate technology because it means that you're not a real deaf person. And that was a line of thinking that existed. And it really kind of was a collectivized thinking, and it was very useful at that point. But the thinking has moved on tremendously to kind of just welcoming as many deaf people to kind of create a sense of community. So if you have an implant, fabulous. If you want to keep it, amazing. If you have hearing aids, cool. If you don't use technology, that's your choice. It doesn't matter. Just kind of hang out with us. And there's, if you want to learn Auslan or any sign language, you do that. Do whatever suits your body. So it's coming kind of from a perspective of choice and opportunity, whereas the medical model is like, you're fixed, you don't need them, you're no longer deaf. And it's just a really different perspective of the body and the deaf experience.
So before I said cochlear, when what I actually meant was hearing aids, sorry, yes. And my question, which is my final question for you before we go to audience questions, is something I found quite profound that I'd never thought about before, which was that when you had the trial of the hearing aids, the way you wrote about sort of silence or quiet as a presence rather than an absence of sound. Can you talk a little bit about that sort of conceptually?
Probably my favorite thing in the world is silence. And it, to me, it means safety. So kind of going back to that idea of I need my eyes to see where sound is and to kind of figure out where people are in space. If I'm in a silent room, or if I'm in a room where, for example, I'm kind of in a corner, like there's this behind me, like somebody could creep up behind me, but chances are low. But the idea that I'm aware of where I am in space gives me a great deal of comfort and security. Because if I'm in a room where there's background noise or in a city street, I'm thinking, I'm alert, I'm on, something could happen. I have to kind of, you know, maneuver myself around sound. Whereas if I'm by myself or in a place of silence, I'm in the place. It's relaxing. It's So being present within my body as opposed to watching.
Thank you. Does anyone have any questions for Fiona? I'm also just going to check to see if we had any come in online. If you're watching, you should be able to type a question into the Q&A box, not the chat box.
Don't worry, Mum, don't type.
But I'm sure there's at least one or two questions in the room here. Anyone? Let me just check. None? Yes.
Definitely. So what I heard was, why don't we teach Auslan in schools, and like, why shouldn't we? Like, it's great. I absolutely agree. And I think a lot of it does come back to that idea of in Australia, we're like the practical nation that fixes things. And there's such a pride that, yeah, we've fixed all these deaf kids. Aren't we awesome? So I think there's still a lack of respect that Auslan is a complete and whole language. I think on a community level, people are like, oh, it's so beautiful. Look at it. It's really beautiful, without actually understanding. It's a language, and it should be represented and it should be taught. And the only access that we have to it at the moment is through emergency announcements for natural disasters. Like, very few people have actually seen Auslan in kind of a way that is conversational and funny and flirty, and all they have seen is an interpreter relay horrific facts. So you can just imagine how beautiful and wonderful it would be if we had access to the language being used conversationally. And there's a real gap in the lack, comparing to the America and the UK, where they have really incredible films and television shows in their sign languages. Whereas in Australia, there's one kids TV show and it's really great. Like, I've learned a lot of Auslan from that kids show, but where is like the TV show where there's like young, fun, deaf people just like getting along, living their lives, signing away? I mean, we need to have more language integrated throughout our society for it to be respected.
There are some really great questions coming through online. Just a quick comment from Janine, which I'm going to read out because I agree with. I loved the line in the book, "There is nothing more exhausting than a vulnerability hangover." That was a good one. Off the back of that question, though, a question from Shannon. So many parallels between healthcare and education, brackets, neoliberalism, !! close brackets. Could you say more about using strength-based language rather than impairment and deficit, etc.? This would be especially useful when talking to parents who still see disability as a stigma. Thank you.
That's a really great question. I think steer away from euphemisms. That's something that happens in disability all the time, of the kid with special needs and you're just differently able. That's incredibly condescending, and it's actually making it more confusing. And it's also leading to the idea, particularly with the phrase special needs, that that disabled child is asking for more than just equality and human rights. It's a real bugbear for me. A place of strength is a place of honesty and just having those frank conversations of, how do you choose to identify? What are your access requirements? And kind of having that across the board for anyone, and making that a standard approach really just kind of normalizes the idea that we have different bodies.
This is this exact same thing with relationships and sexuality education.
Yeah, totally.
Of the problems are when people just can't even bring themselves to use the right words.
Yeah. And I think a lot of people are afraid of saying disabled or disability as if they'll catch it or cause offense. I think the book Growing Up Disabled in Australia has really shifted the conversation, because booksellers and people buying books are actually having to say the word disabled. And I think this repetition is going to create change.
A quick comment from Rebecca. I never got my pen license. So you've got an audience there. There's a question from someone about Auslan being different in American/UK, which I am not going to take just yet because it's explained really beautifully in the book. What I do want to take is a question from Leal. I think that's how you pronounce your name, Bridgeford. How did you find the publishing industry as a deaf person? How has ableism and stigma affected your writing career?
It's been really welcoming. I've been very lucky with text. I found it really interesting being as a deaf writer, how much deafness is in my writing and approach to writing, which has been kind of a surprise, but a really lovely surprise. I hope when I write more in the future that I really lean into that. So in terms of syntax in particular and things like that, and certain phraseology might be considered incorrect or unusual, but it is a real kind of deaf approach to understanding language. Also, on just a practical level, my editor was so great because I do miss out kind of prepositional words a lot. So the and. When I'm writing, even if I'm paying attention, those little words just slip through the net completely. And I'm quite fluent when I'm speaking, but when I'm writing, those words just slip out. And she's like, Fiona, do you want me to just, you know, and I'm like, yeah, just, you know, put them back in there for me, because even if I'm paying attention, those little words just zip through my brain. I just can't grasp onto them.
That's about all we have time for. Are there any more questions in the room? Oh, see, this always happens. People don't put their hands up at the start, and we'll take two. Sorry, Beck. We'll take two in the room. Blue and then green. Did you get most of that?
I did. Correct. I did.
And could you repeat a brief version of that so the people watching at home can hear it?
You articulated it so well, but it's the idea that we have a medical model and a social model, but if someone who is coming from a different cultural experience where English in Australia might not be their first language, how can they kind of navigate the medical model, but also then kind of understand that a social model exists? She said it so much better than that, by the way, like so articulate. And I wish that was an essay in itself, because I think there is something that really needs to be understood, that this having access to English in Australia is such a privilege in navigating the healthcare system to a sickening degree, because there is a limit, there's a lack of interpreters and a lack of time and understanding that information needs to be delivered in multiple languages. And I think during COVID in particular, we saw such a lag in information being disseminated to communities in multiple languages and the immediate impacts of that. And then the kind of fear mongering and blame that came from the media as well was just absolutely horrific and sickening. I think there's a lot of issues to do that, to do with that, not just in disability, but a person's ability to navigate the healthcare system is difficult, and you need an advocate whether you have English or not. I think a lot of things need to change with healthcare in Australia. To stick to the question in general, I think there's real downfall to the social model as well, because it kind of, it was developed in academia and still has a lot of academic information around it and hasn't really been translated into this kind of social concept. We still talk about it in really kind of stifled phrases. And the same with the medical model, but that's always going to be like that because that's a power construct they have. I think the best way to kind of bridge the gaps from a personal level, if particularly if somebody has different language requirements, is the idea of community and collectivization and disabled voices coming together to share their experiences on a human and personal level. Certainly, even though I went through my education understanding the medical model, I knew little to nothing about disability until I actually spoke to other disabled people. And I was like, holy hell, this is information. Even though I know English, I just had no idea about. And it's that idea that asking for access is a skill, advocating for yourself is a skill. And I think we learn the disabled community has so much knowledge that is underappreciated. And if somebody's in a situation where they are disabled, reaching out and chatting to other disabled people is going to be life-changing in so many ways, and it will empower you.
So much of what you just said is just almost exactly analogous to the situation with law and legal professionals, and how so much of the language they use is just deliberately inaccessible because they're like shoring up their access to that knowledge and preventing other people from, yeah. And just that lived experience, like experience is not recognized as like special expertise.
Yeah, and expertise is such,
yeah,
that's a really great word for it. And I think disabled people have this level of expertise that if only non-disabled people would realize, you guys are missing out.
We had one more question here.
Definitely even thinking about access is amazing because a lot of people don't even think about it. So
just for those watching at home, the question was about closed captions, and the person from the audience was saying that they find reading the automatically generated captions instead of captions people have typed out to be very frustrating and not good.
Yep.
Sorry.
Was so smooth. I love it. Auto-generated captions are horrendous. They are just, if they're right 60% of the time, it's amazing, but it's not true access because the information is rubbish, really. It's gibberish words. The way you phrase that question makes me suspect that you are thinking about access in a way that is a responsibility that you have as somebody who's on the internet and working in kind of a digital space. I really wish that most people realize that they have responsibilities as citizens in the digital landscape to do their bit to create access. A lot of people are lazy, frankly, online, and they don't think of image descriptions or captionings and things like that. And I think that's just poor citizenship, and it doesn't take that much time and effort to implement good digital skills online to make these spaces more welcoming. In terms of auto-generated stuff, you can go on to YouTube and edit later if you have the capability and the time. But really kind of the AI isn't up to the par just yet. So there is going to be human labor involved to make things, captioning in particular, accessible. But it sounds like you're doing a great job.
I'm going to end the evening with a comment from Rachel Darcy. I am also a healthcare professional, a dietitian, brackets, also a librarian. Shout out to librarians. And I have, I'm sorry, I'm going to mispronounce this, otosclerosis in both ears. Thank you, Fiona, for your honest comments on patient-centered care. I hope to widen this conversation around proper client-centered care, ableist language, and using proper terminology. Maybe this will be the way I tell my colleagues about my hearing impairment. Your book has given me courage and pride in my disabled voice and the power it has. So thank you for that comment, Rachel. And I think that's a perfect point at which we can all thank Fiona.
Thank you.
As always, we announce at the end of the evening what the next book is for next month. And I feel like a real wanker because it's my book. But I was asked by the library if I would do my own book for my own book club. And so in compensation for how wanky that makes me feel, I can tell you all very excitingly that Rick Morton, who is the best person on the planet, will be talking to me. So you can come for him. And that will be the final Thursday of next month. Thank you so much for joining us, and have a nice night. And thank you, everyone at home.